Welcome. Good morning. Good to see everybody. Hey, I slept in late. I'm sorry. This is coming out. I at 3 I was up. I'm going, oh, gosh darn it, 3 o'clock. I don't want to get out of bed at 3. And then next thing I look, it's 4:30. I go, son of a gun. I slept in late today. Damn it. Well, that's the way it is. That's why I look bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Whatever that expression means, but something my parents always said. Let's first talk the opening today. It's a place in Detroit called the Heidelberg Project. The Heidelberg Project came up. There was a guy and that lived. This is in East Detroit. This is in a really bad area. And he saw all the stuff people were throwing away. So he just began taking it. And on his street, there were these old abandoned houses. And he just began putting it on the houses, stapling it, making piles of things, doing some paintings. It became his urban art project. On Facebook, you can still see it. They have this house. It's called Vinyl Siding, and it had all these records stapled to the house. I mean, or nailed onto the house. So this huge two-story house is full of albums. That's the Heidelberg Project. Well, and I saw this maybe 10 years ago. I'd been down there, and it was very interesting. When you go there, there's signs that say, park on this street, lock your doors. Don't park on another street because your car might not be there. Well, in that 10 years, something had happened. There was, for a while there, all kinds of cars were being broken into. The artist knew who it was. And finally told the cops, hey, here's the guy that's doing this. He's breaking into all these cars and needs to be stopped. And they arrested him. Well, he got out of jail and he knew who told him. He went back to this Heidelberg Project area and burned down, I think, 4 of the houses. Burned them down, arson. And so, like the vinyl house, it's gone now. And there's a house just filled with stuffed animals, just stuffed animals taped all over it. Really sad. I mean, they were so cool. It's still, this thing goes probably a block and a half. It looks like just a bunch of junk or whatever, but the guy's just taking these things and creating his own urban art. And it's in East Detroit, the Heidelberg Project. It is not a place you want to go walking around. I mean, my wife, do we get out of the car, honey? Yes, of course we're getting out of the car. This is so cool. It's always good to revisit that. All right. Couple real quick things I just want to talk about. First off, this is sponsored by Mount Rushmore. Mount Rushmore is the only place where you can go and see 4 stoned presidents. Yes, it's a potheader's dream there. contest. A quick clarification for those. 5's the minimum I want you to show. You can show a whole lot more. I don't care. What I'm looking for is I just enjoy. Why is that? Why do you like that go-to album? But 5's the minimum. I don't care how many you show. Keep it under 100, though. Otherwise, it'll be longer than one of my videos, damn it. I actually have a couple videos ready to go. They're set. Eric Weinbender's. I've got yours recorded. I just got to put it out. And I do have my first top 100, 100 to 91. I went 36 minutes, folks. Oh, my God. I apologize in advance for that sucker. It's just, gosh, dang it. I have to figure out how to cut that. So I'm not going to cut that one because I don't do them over. But my next one. So regretfully, you might get a little bit of too much Steve this week. Apologies for that. Hey, it's the way it is, right? And I think that is about it. Yeah, we should probably get going. Seems to me there is something else. I caught another mouse. 4. Or I must have an infestation. Now I'm worried. I've never had that many mice in the world. It took 2 weeks to get this last one. I think I know kind of where, but okay. But you're here for the vinyl, right? So let's just, I have some great stuff that people have sent me. I have some amazing things. So let's begin and let's just go big. Go big, go home, right? This is an original Albert King, born under a bad sign. This is one of those important blues albums. And look at that beautiful old school Stax label. I was in Denver visiting my son, and he has this great record store only a few blocks from him. And so I decided to go. Funny thing is, nobody wanted to come with me. Isn't that something? I'd tell you the name of the record store, but I'd have to remember it, wouldn't I? There on the wall, the beautiful wall, the wall of value, not the wall of value, the wall that makes you slobber, that sucks me in. I saw this. There was this glow about it. It was like a halo all over. It was the most amazing thing. It was like a religious experience. And there it was. And I do not own this. I don't even own it in CD. Well, I looked at it. And I left it. And I just began shopping. I mean, I was finding stuff all over the place. It was incredible what I was finding there. And then it kept looking at me. And this is a carnivorous store. It's so big. Finally, I put back probably half of it. Not all of it. And I went and I grabbed this. They also had the Birthday Party's original album. But this is the one I wanted. This one meant a lot to me. And I bought it. And it is great. Albert King, he did this in 1967. He really hadn't had any music out there, done anything. It just wasn't as well known. And he was 43 years old. He went, and this is his first album he did for Stax. And this changed blues, the sound of blues, because it became soul blues because Booker T and the MGs back him up. I mean, how more powerful is that? Incredible. Albert King, I kind of think of like Miles Davis. Miles Davis didn't like to use a lot of notes. Albert King didn't either. He didn't believe in how many notes can he put in a blues solo. It wasn't about the chords. He was minimalistic. He would only play like the top three strings. And it was more on how he would do his phrases and how many different sounds he could bend out of those three strings. And he wasn't even always in tune, but he was so strong he could bend a string and bend that note to kind of bring it back into tune. Really amazing. This, if you want to get into blues and you're thinking about it, this takes you in a different direction where soul was added into it. It is an extremely important blues album. It changed what we were getting from Muddy and Howlin' Wolf and Booker, oh my God, Johnny Lee Hooker. I had the Hooker part right. And I slept in late. It changed the course. It changed the sound. And when I think of Robert Cray, I think of this. Jimi Hendrix, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Eric Clapton, highly influenced by Albert King. This was an incredible find, original copy. Wow! I'd like to say it's a grail, but I hadn't been searching for it. There it was, in light. I like this group. I want this. This is a reissue on 180 gram vinyl. Spaceman 3, and it's Sound of Confusion. Wow. Spaceman 3, they're out of England. And I showed last week on my bootlegs. I got a bootleg of this. They were formed from 82 to 91. This album came out in 1986. I believe it was the first full-length album. Best described, here's just different ways in which these guys are described. Garage rock, noise rock, space rock, dream rock, psychedelic rock, it's all there. They kind of called themselves nod music. Spacey and drowsy, and you kind of nod. I mean, these guys, they fully admitted, we are a drug band, man. That's what we are. It is full of full-on, fuzzed-out guitars. It is just, it is heavy psychedelic. It's part of the second, you know, the second wave of psychedelia that came out in the 80s. And these guys were really there. But, you know, they once described that they wanted to make music that felt like a drug high hitting you. Or, and this is the real scary one, they said, like the life is leaving you if you slit your wrist. I mean, God, how graphic is that one? It's just really, it's stuff I've loved for years. This track I'm going to do on here is called Hey Man, and it's gospel influence. For those of you who are older, in the 60s, there's a movie from Sidney Poitier called Lilies of the Field, and they have this song that goes, Amen, 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 Amen. It's a gospel. They take that song, and I'm telling you, and they go, hey man, hey man, hey man. You know, when I first heard it, I go, why are they doing Lilies of that song from Lilies of the Field, Amen? It was Hey Man. Influential group. This really brought along a lot of psychedelic, stoner kind of rock, noise rock. Really great stuff. So happy to get this one. Sound of Confusion. This is a big deal for me. Big deals. And this has been shown in the VC. This has been shown a lot. I know Vinyl Douche, Sam, does this. Hannah's talked about him. Dean, and Dean's Top 100, talked about Galaxy 500. I think he had Spaceman 3 in there too. Sorry, Dean, I did not memorize all 100. My apologies. This is from Galaxy 500, On Fire. Dean Wareham of Luna, this was his first album that he did. Again, great stuff. A group that I have loved, I've had on CD, and in fact, today's CD is from this because you can't play tracks. But it's good stuff, and I love this album. So I'm putting that on here. These guys were influenced by the Velvet Underground, heavily influenced by the Velvet Underground. It has these mid-tempo grooves that go on and just this very subdued percussion in the background. Again, fuzzed out guitars, but it's more in a kind of a soft, dreamy way. In fact, it's called Dream Pop or Slowcore. They were one of the first people. They kind of got this movement going, you know, out of America. You know, Spaceman 3, when you listen to that, you know, you're thinking then Jesus and the Mary Chain Gang. You're thinking Bloody Valentine. These guys are starting a whole different kind of sound here in the U.S. Similar with all the feedback and the fuzzed out, but more dreamy. They even do a George Harrison song on here. Isn't it a pity? Great stuff. This has been on my want list for a long time, and vinyl. I find I'll just screw it. You know, I have the CD. I'll just get it because I love Luna. Luna's one of my all-time favorite groups. Hey, I bet you'll see that in the video. Found this in Denver. I actually found a lot in Denver, and I haven't shown any of it because I'm so far behind. Lee Morgan, Tomcat. This was recorded in 1964, not released until 1980. Isn't that nuts, huh? And it's a really great album. What had happened is Lee Morgan had done Sidewinder. They pressed 4,000 copies of Sidewinder. That's how good they felt about this album. It's going to be so awesome. We're just going to do 4,000 copies. And it took off, and it was going nuts. So the people at Blue Note going, oh man. So Morgan gave them this, and there was another one album that he recorded in 64. And they're looking, no. We need Sidewinder 2. Give me Sidewinder 2, not this. And it got shelved. And wherever they put that on the shelf, it's like a set of car keys. It was, where the hell did it go? And couldn't find it. They finally did, and they released this in 1980. And it's a fun Lee Morgan album, at least I thought. So he has an all-star cast. Listen to this. Lee Morgan on trumpet, Jackie McLean, alto sax, Curtis Fuller, trombone, McCoy Tyner, piano, Bob Cranshaw on bass, Art Blakey on drums. Isn't that the kind of cast that just blows your mind? Wow. Morgan loved the six-piece. He loved the sextet. That was his favorite way to go. In the 60s, he recorded over 20 albums as either a leader or as a sideman. You know, he passed in 72. It's just, you know, he was so prolific during that period. He's one of my favorite jazz guys. When you listen to this, you just get, this is this cool 60s vibe. I'm going to play a track from Tomcat, and you're going to hear McCoy Tyner's piano, and it's just this, oh man, it's cool. And the way this piano goes, and it has this, you know, when you think the word Tomcat, you get that feel from that song. I mean, you can hear it, you can see it in there. Rigor Mortis was one that was kind of popular. There is Exotique, and that's like this finger popping, swinging 60s feel song. Great fun stuff that came off this album. Really happy to find that thing off it. Tomcat out of 1980. Go back. How about let's go to, oh, here's something I forgot to do. I'm sorry about that. Spaceman 3. Okay, I got a postcard. It's a download code. For you early morning risers, if you want to hear Spaceman 3, there you go. First come, first serve on the download card for that group. I had a couple others I was going to share. I'll have to find them later. Oh well. I'll share them when I find them, right? Right. Okay, we have the Hollies Evolution. Picked this up at my local shop here, Radio Wasteland Records. Thank you, Jim. Off Epic. And it was the Hollies' second album. This came out in 1967. When they made this album, they made it, they were recording it at Apple Studios, and oh, I don't know, there's something else going on. Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. If you don't think they didn't have their ear to the door, well, you're just stupid. These guys, by this time, the Hollies were tired of being this little pop band. You know, all the little girls, woo, look at them, woo, woo, woo. They wanted something serious, and they wanted to go psychedelic. So what they had is the photographer, a guy named was Carl Ferris. They asked him to do the photograph, and this has been said to be the first really psychedelic photo. The English version, this is the American version because it has Carrie Ann. Hey, Carrie Ann. It wasn't on the English version, but it has really trippy looking, the Hollies is down here, really, really trippy looking. Here they did more of that spacey look. But there was this plastic bag in front of them and designed, and they were in there kind of pushing it out to give it this trippy type of look. And you know what? They did. They did bring in some more fuzz guitars. Some of it doesn't sound really what I would call, wow, spacey, psychedelic. And there is some that does. I'm going to play you, I believe it's... I'm playing you something off this. How about that? And for the life, I thought it would stop right there. I think it's Rain on the Windows, so I'm going to play you. But you're going to hear it. You can hear what they were trying to get at and do. Not everything was like that. You think Carrie Ann, you think that's a psychedelic song? I don't, but maybe you do. This was a nice pickup, though. Good stuff.
Is growing, I'm sure it started showing. This feeling getting stronger, I can't hold that much longer. It's swelling deep inside, emotions I can't hide. Then the heartache begins. I'm telling you, the heartache begins.
I received some stuff from Hannah, the Omaha Introvert, and Bo from Earhead 6. And they gave me some albums a few weeks back. They were at a record show and they saw some stuff and they picked some things up and sent me. And thank you very much. They also have their channel that they did together. And for the life of me, I'm sorry. I can't remember. I can't plug it. My apologies. But Omaha Introvert, Hannah, and Earhead 6, Bo. Everyone knows them. Great. Both great channels. And Bo, I do get your jokes. And they're funny. They sent me this. Never heard this group. Circus Maximus. Well, doesn't that, again, how about one of them kind of trippy album covers? Isn't that neat? This came out in 1967. Might have been their only one. This is Psych. And it's kind of a folk, rock, and jazz all put together. The thing is, the two guys that started it, Bob Bruno and Jeff Walker, the issue was Bruno liked jazz and Walker liked folk, and they couldn't agree. And so they wound up breaking up after only about 1 year. When they went to record this is recorded on Vanguard. Yeah, Vanguard, you know, the psych label that everyone knows, right? When they went in, their name of their group was Lost Sea Dreamer. And Vanguard says, no, we don't like that title, change it. What? You don't like Lost Sea Dreamer? Why not? Maybe because if you think about the initials, LSD. Well, Vanguard was smart enough to go, we get you. We understand what you're trying to do. Screw you. So I called it Circus Maximus, which is, that's kind of a fun name. And it says, presented in the center ring of an electric circus, under the visual big top of flowing multicolored light, Circus Maximus is the biggest circus, the circus of the mind, theatered in a tent of imagination. This was great stuff. Thank you very much. This was a fun listen to, and I quite enjoyed it. A little trippy, which I'm not known for that.
In the old town, in the old name, and who's to blame? Ask you what's your name? Tell your mind to say, my name to say.
Sent me this. The Youngbloods did not have this. This has the song Get Together on there. Became really, really, really a big song. They do other ones like CC Rider, which is really neat. This was a fun album. This was done in 1967. The Youngbloods were around from 67 to 72. Kind of a folk rock, a little bit of psychedelic rock going on in there. You know, they kind of formed in Greenwich Village is where they were playing. What was sad, Get Together, it took 2 years for that to become a hit. I think a commercial grabbed it and people go, wow, that's kind of neat. And it became a hit. And it's a song about unity. It's kind of, you know, again, this is done in 67. You can hear Summer of Love, unity. Let's come on, people, now smile on your brother. Everybody get together, time to love one another right now. You know that song. When 9/11 happened, a radio, the people that own all the radios, Clear Channel, you know, they own like almost all the stations, they put out a list of songs that they felt had objectionable lyrics for the time. Get Together was considered objectionable lyrics. What the hell? Don't know, but it did. This thing gave me, I talked about War, I picked up a lot of War. I never had an Eric Burdon War album. Boom, bam, thank you, ma'am, there it is. This is the first Eric Burdon album with Spill Your Wine. I've never seen it on MGM, and so I was delighted. There it is, the look of, supposed to be like a W, see, the three fingers, white and black arm, Eric Burdon and War. Couldn't been happier. This was just, I was kind of, you almost peed your pants. I was so excited to see this thing finally had it. And it was funny, that week I was in Toledo, Ohio. Always a happening place. Gotta love Toledo, right? Everyone been there? Probably not. And I found the second one, The Black Man's Burden. Oh, funny. Eric Burdon and War, the second album that they did. And they did these in 1970. And there's Naked Chicks on there. Wow. I'm telling you, if you were a kid, that's like opening up a little Playboy or Penthouse there. Fun to find that. I was really excited to have both War albums of Eric Burdon. Super good. And then they gave me this one. This is Ian Dury's second. I just want to call him Drury for whatever reason, because there's a hotel chain, Drury and Dury. Ian Dury and the Blockheads. This is the second one, Do It Yourself. Came out in 1979. This was really known for the, they had 34 different covers of Wallpaper. Look on Discogs, pisses you off. Which one is it? Damn it, I got the wrong Wallpaper. That's how you can tell them apart. It got tinges of reggae in there, a little bit of dance hall and pub rock. Ian Dury and the Blockheads. Yeah, the guy was in his upper 30s when he started and was considered a punkers. The punkers hated old people, but they accepted Ian Dury. That was great. And then, Mike, from Mike Guitar Player 07, nice young man, he's working on his master's degrees. You see his channel, he does a lot of videos, entered my contest. I love Mike. Mike is such, you're an outstanding young man, Mike, I think you are. He sent me a couple albums. One was Leo Sayer, Thunder in My Heart. I like Leo Sayer, I think he's pretty cool. You know, it's music from my childhood. This came out in 1977. We'll just call it Leo Sayer's disco album. What's kind of crazy is Leo Sayer, he had a big hit. You Make Me Feel Like Dancing, not on this one. Came out in 76 or 75. The song, You Make Me Feel Like Dancing, and I Want to Know, won a Grammy. Get this, it won a Grammy for the best rhythm and blues album. Song, best rhythm and blues song. What? You Make Me Feel Like Dancing? Whew. You know, the Grammys have always had a problem with that. But Jethro Tull getting heavy metal, that was okay. Don't dish them. Fun stuff. And he sent me this one, Sarah Vaughan, Volume 2, Great Songs from Hit Shows. I don't have any Sarah Vaughan. You talk about a beautiful woman with a beautiful voice. She could have been an opera singer. You know, she was much different than Ella Fitzgerald or Billie Holiday. She had a beautiful way. It's done on Mercury. And she recorded for Mercury from 54 to 1960. It's really, really incredible voice. She won 4 Grammys in her lifetime. So this was a really great pickup. Enjoyed it immensely. So thank you. Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Bo. I really do appreciate that. That was really nice of you. All right, there we go. I tried to keep it down. It's going to go over 30. I have samples to put on there. Absolutely, my apologies once again, but I'm consistent, right? I consistently go along. I consistently talk too much, so consistency is important. Thank you, as always, for tuning in for this. Thank you. I've had over 30 entries on my contest. It goes till November 15th. Because that just seemed like an easy date to remember. So please feel free to enter that. Have fun. For those of you that don't make videos, you can enter it. Look at the video. All you have to do is write it in the comments. You're entered. For those that want to do a video, boom, do me a video. Love it. Fun. I appreciate it. Cheers. Happy whatever. Oh, it's Sunday. That's what it is. And get yourself some coffee. And thank you for tuning in. Bye.